Hey y'all. In this video, I'm going to be giving you an update, a long overdue update, on the progression of my plan for budgeting and seasonal spending for this year. I'm a person who really loves beautiful things, and frankly, I really enjoy shopping. I tend to think that as a passionate lover of beautiful things, some shopping can be healthy, but too much shopping is definitely unhealthy. So I'm always working to balance that. How much shopping is right for me? How much is it appropriate for me to spend on beautiful things? This video is basically about that journey. If you like this and you're not subscribed, I hope that you'll go ahead and subscribe. And let's get right into the meat of the video. In case you are new here, let me give you some context. My name is Hannah, and I used to have a real problem overspending on makeup, skincare, clothing, and homewares and accessories. And in 2018, I notoriously quit shopping for an entire year. I did a whole no-buy year. I basically gave my brain chemistry a reset. And since then, I've been slowly forging a new relationship, a new psychological relationship with beauty and money. In 2019, the year directly after my no-buy year, I had a strict monthly budget. And then in 2020, I had a yearly budget. And I stuck to both of them pretty closely. And both of those years, those budgeting years, have helped me in the course of forging this new relationship. There are already a bunch of videos about my no-buy year on YouTube. I started my channel in 2018, so I documented the whole thing. And actually, all of the videos that I filmed that year are collected into a playlist in chronological order. So if you want to go back and basically experience the entire no-buy year with me, if you haven't done that, or if you want to do it again, you can watch them all through that playlist, and I'll link that down below. And there are also a number of videos that I filmed after my no-buy year, kind of looking back on it. I feel like the most important lessons actually came in the aftermath, so I'll link some of those videos down below too. But here's the short story in case you haven't seen those videos and you don't care to go back and watch them. I want us all to be on the same page moving forward in this video and beyond. So the short story is that in retrospect, when I look back at my no-buy year, and at the months and years leading up to it, I can see now that what was going on was that I was using shopping to distract myself from bad feelings, basically. I was using shopping to repress and to try to ameliorate, but also to repress feelings of inadequacy, kind of like a panic, like a constant low level of panic about the fact that my life wasn't unfolding in the way that I thought it was going to unfold. Basically, the fact that my life wasn't perfect. Guess what, Mary? Nobody's life is perfect, and nobody's life unfolds the way that they thought that it was going to unfold, no matter how it looks on Instagram. I can see that clearly from where I'm sitting now after everything that I've gone through. But back then, it was really hard for me to see the forest for the trees, especially because the dopamine rush that I would get from looking for something to want, from wanting it, and then from buying it, those chemicals were a really effective temporary band-aid. And so I kept chasing them, and the chasing of them kept me distracted, kept me from looking inward and doing the work that I needed to do on myself from the inside to get out of that bad place. I was actively keeping myself in a constant state of wanting something new, wanting something different, wanting something that I didn't have. I think because I was dependent on the brain chemicals that are associated with that state of being, that state of wanting what you don't have. But of course, the stuff that I ended up buying because of going through that process, the stuff was always a letdown, right? The excitement, the passion, the chemicals, none of it lasted much longer after buying the thing. And then I was always feeling truly terrible about how much money I was spending, because I was spending way more than I could afford. So it was a cycle. It was self-perpetuating. I shopped to distract myself or to temporarily put a band-aid on the feelings of anxiety and self-loathing. But the fact that I was spending so much time and money shopping, and the fact that the feeling, the band-aid didn't last, you know what I mean? The good feelings didn't last, and I was spending so much time and money, that fueled those feelings of anxiety and self-loathing, and around and around and around. The no-buy year was a great solution for me because it was really long. It was a whole year, and it took a really long time for the instinct to shop for unhealthy reasons to die. Like, it was a really entrenched habit, the habit of brain and body and sort of spirit. It was like a habit of spirit that I had been doing for so long that I couldn't just like fix it in a month or a week or read a book or something. It took a long time. I would say it took fully the first 6 months of my no-buy year. After about the 6 month mark, I felt that I had changed, but I kept going for the entire year. And what happened was, after that part of myself, that habit died, I kind of experienced a second trauma, like kind of an emotional mental breakdown, because I started having to face all of the bad stuff that I had been repressing. And that processing that stuff took like at least another year after that. And then I've made some more videos since then, kind of, you know, reflecting on that. And again, I'll link the playlist and I'll link those videos. The one, if you just want to watch one to kind of get caught up, there's the kind of the last one that I made about my no-buy year, how my no-buy year changed my life. That's the one that I would recommend watching. I'll link it at the top down below. I feel like the version of myself that shopped before my no-buy year has essentially completely gone, completely evaporated. Like, the version of myself that would spend hours every weekend in Sephora, that would break into a cold sweat whenever she checked her bank balance, I don't know her. Like, she's gone. I've been in therapy for years now, and I took this amazing class last year. It was like an online course in compassion. I have developed a practice of gratitude and compassion that I think has really helped me to weather, I don't know, like a very strange year in 2020 that also went along with, for me, some crushing setbacks in my personal life and in my professional life that I haven't talked about on YouTube and probably never will. But I just feel like I have tools to weather the storms of life that I didn't have before my no-buy year. And what I was doing was I was just panicking and shopping. So I can see, because of how I made it through this past year and how I'm still making it through this like currently kind of crazy time in my life, I can see from that how far I've come. Obviously, I still have a long way to go. I mean, I personally feel like I'm still at the beginning of this part of my journey. Like, I had to do the no-buy year to kind of break out, and now I'm starting to grow and to become the person that I want to be, and I'm not that person yet. But I can confidently say that I'm not the fundamentally unhappy person that I was when I was caught in that shopping cycle before my no-buy year. And that is because of hard work that I've done on myself. But, and here we're getting into it, but I still want more things than I can afford, and I still want things that I can't afford, especially because I'm a freelancing career creative with an unpredictable paycheck. A paycheck, but an unpredictable paycheck. And I want Miu Miu sunglasses and Gucci lipsticks and Ulla Johnson dresses. I want those things not because I think that they're gonna fix my life or change my life. I think that that's why I wanted them. Actually, I know that that's why I wanted stuff like that before my no-buy year. I want things like that because they're beautiful and evocative, and life is short and aesthetics are powerful. And I genuinely love the art form that is fashion. Like, I kind of think of it as like a version of drag. Like, I genuinely love the version of drag that is everyday dressing. And to me, drag is one of the greatest art forms in history. The good news is that I love loving beautiful things in this way. I love buying, when I am able to buy them, beautiful things to augment the joy that is already in my life, instead of desperately trying to buy my way out of my life, which is what I was doing before. And I'm glad that I didn't like throw the baby out with the bathwater. Like, I'm glad I didn't have to throw the baby out with the bathwater. And by that, I mean, I'm glad that I didn't have to impose like a lifelong shopping ban, or I didn't have to fully emotionally disconnect, like permanently emotionally disconnect from my love of beauty in order to break those old bad habits and kind of give myself a do-over and reset my brain chemistry. I mean, I did it for a year. You know, I was on a shopping ban for a year and I kind of like took a break for a year, but now I'm rebuilding or I'm like building something new. I don't want to be a lifelong non-shopper. I just never want to be the obsessive, unhappy, and overspending shopper that I was for so many years before my no-buy year. And that brings us finally to the heart of this video, right? Which is my 2021 plan for moderated spending. So at the beginning of this year, I came up with this idea to have shopping seasons. And what I'll do is I'm gonna give you a quick recap of the plan, but I'm also gonna link in the description box along with all the other videos, the first video, I think it was the first video of this year. And that's the video in which I outlined this plan. So if you didn't watch that then and you'd really like the full background, you can click through and watch that video. But here it is in brief. My plan was to have 4 weeks spread evenly throughout the year, 4 weeks during which I would shop. And in between those weeks, I planned to be essentially on a complete no-buy. So I was gonna do the first week of January, the first week of April, first week of July, and I think the first week of October, right? Those are gonna be my 4 week-long shopping seasons spread throughout the year. Here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna tell you what happened because spoiler alert, didn't quite go as planned. I'm gonna tell you what happened kind of like in a story time way. I'm just gonna talk through my actions and my thought process as it was unfolding. And then I will come back and I'll kind of give you my current analysis because now I'm looking back over and I have thoughts and theories about like why it went down the way that it did. And then I have some takeaways that I'll share with you towards the end. At the beginning of January, I did about a week. I did a shopping season. It was so lovely. I just kind of relaxed into it. I had this freedom. I bought a couple of beautiful things. And then I stopped shopping. And then we got to the shopping season at the beginning of April. And what happened was the shopping season arrived and I wasn't ready. I was really busy. I hadn't had time. I think that when I made the plan, I thought that in the weeks leading up to the month, I would be getting excited and I would be looking online and trying to decide what I was going to buy and kind of curating shopping carts, thinking about my budget. And then as soon as the week happened, like the first week of April, I would be like, purchase, 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 purchase. You know what I mean? Like I would buy all the things, they'd all arrive and then it would be just like it was in January. And then I would just sit back and like stop shopping again for another 4 months. That's what I envisioned happening. But as we approached the first week of April, I didn't really feel like shopping. I didn't know what I wanted for sure. I didn't have like the drive to make those decisions and to like curate those carts. And I was like, I'm not gonna like force myself to shop if I don't feel like shopping. I just didn't expect that. I didn't expect that like one of the shopping seasons would arrive and I would be like, I just am not, I'm ready to like spend my quarterly budget right now. But the other thing that was going on then was that vaccination was on the horizon. So we were just starting to realize in my household that we were all going to be vaccinated within like weeks, if not months. I can't remember exactly how the timeline went, but I knew at that moment, at the beginning of April, that it was going to be way before my next shopping season that I was vaccinated and free to go shopping in person. Like my favorite way to shop for clothes specifically is to go to designer consignment shops, secondhand shops, and find gems. And you can do that a little bit online. Like most of the clothing that I bought in January was from Poshmark. So I have been buying secondhand clothing even in quarantine. But once I realized that I was gonna be vaccinated and I was gonna be able to go shopping in person, I was like, I don't wanna spend my spring budget online and then, you know, a month later, a month and a half later, I'm free to go shopping in person, but I already spent my entire spring budget buying stuff online. And so I've deprived myself of the chance to spend it in this way that I vastly prefer, which is making an outing out of it, maybe going with my friend Julia. Like as soon as we knew we were gonna be vaccinated, I had visions of Julia and me going together, which is something that we used to love to do. And so I didn't wanna get to the point where I was vaccinated and Julia was vaccinated and we had a chance to go out and spend the day together, But like I was on a no buy because I had already spent my entire April budget. So that's another thing that held me back from following through with my plan to spend my budget at the beginning of April. I wanted to save it. And if you are one of my Patreon patrons, then you'll know about this because I have been checking in more frequently with my patrons on Patreon. I film a little check-in there every couple of weeks, and I've been talking about this stuff over there. For this, for Big YouTube, I wanted to wait until I was kind of like through it and I was able to look back and tell you what happened and analyze what happened, you know? But on Patreon, I've been giving more like a in the moment, intermittent updates. And so I talked to my Patreon patrons about this in April, and I was like, you know, what I'm doing, this is what I said on Patreon. I was like, what I'm doing is I'm just transplanting my shopping week. I'm just gonna move it into the future to whichever week makes sense when it happens. So like at some point in late April or May or June, at some point, Julia and I will be able to go out and go shopping together, and then I'll put the week there. Then that'll be it. And in all other ways, I'll stick to the plan. That was what I originally thought. But here's what happened. What didn't happen. It just never really happened that Julia and I had like a day that we could spend together going out shopping. We're both really busy. And even though we would like to, we haven't been able to. So, you know, April turned into May, May turned into June. I got vaccinated. And then, you know, I kind of started to see that I almost never have time. I mean, I think even after I realized I wanted to, I think it was weeks before I could even take an afternoon and like go out to a designer consignment shop by myself. But because the shopping season had kind of been relaxed, like it was originally the first week of April, and I was sort of like, I'm just gonna move it. Like because I had disrupted my original plan, I had removed the boundaries of my original rules, and I hadn't instituted a really clear secondary plan to take their place. I was like, I think what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna shop later in the season when it feels right. You know, because I was just sort of loosey-goosey about it, I kind of like leaned into that relaxed set of guidelines, and I just started occasionally buying things, always with an eye to what was in my bank account, right? Always keeping track of how much I was spending and how much I could afford. So still budgeting, even though it wasn't in the same way, right? Always checking with myself about what I could spend and how much disposable income I really could put towards these things. Never credit cards, never dipping into savings, still with a very strict sense of value and, you know, making decisions as carefully as I ever did during my budgeting years, during either of my 2 years of strict budgeting. I also started keeping track on a paper calendar of the days when I didn't spend anything and the days when I did spend money. So I have this like paper calendar, a monthly calendar, you know, that shows the days of the month. And I have little star stickers. And I started putting a star on the calendar on every single day that I didn't spend any money. And it's, you know, most days, but I found that very motivating. I'm like motivated to have as many star stickers lining up as possible. So I started using that as a way to just visually, I'm very visual and tactile. And doing that, I could see how much time I was spending not shopping and not spending money. And then every time I did buy something, I would write it on that day. I would not give myself a star, and I would also write what I bought and how much I spent. So I could like look back over the last month or the last 2 months and see how much I was spending, if I needed to add it all up, if I kind of needed to remind myself. And I could also see that I was really not spending money on very many of the days of the month. I've still said no to the majority of the things that I've wanted to buy. Like I'm still saying no to my desires constantly, but I've essentially just been through these past 4 months. They have essentially been one long season of prudent, moderated shopping, or as some people would call it, just regular life, like regular times. But I never thought that I would go back to regular times. I never expected to have regular times again after my no-buy year. So this has been really interesting. There have been some times when I've been like, oh, should I go back on a no-buy? Like I really hate when I say that I'm going to do a thing or I set a rule for myself and then I don't do it. And I especially don't like it when it's public, when I like say I'm going to do something in public and then I don't do it. Part of me has been like, oh, like I need to correct this, or I need to like show contrition and like reestablish structure and control or something like that. And I've even said it a couple of times in my Patreon check-ins. I've been like, I'm probably going to go back on a no-buy after this, or definitely going to need to go on a no-buy for the fall. But every time I sit down and consider it, and I'm like, okay, when should my next seasonal no-buy start? Every time I do that, I'm like, but like, why? Because I don't feel out of control. I'm not spending more than I would have spent if I had stuck to my seasonal budgeting. I'm just spending it more spread out rather than like concentrated in those 2 week periods. And also, there are a couple of things going on in my life right now that would make a no buy, inconvenient is kind of like a kind of not the right word, because it's always going to feel inconvenient. Like if you need to go on a no buy, there are always going to be things that you have to work around. But it's more just like there are some things going on in my life that feel incompatible with a no buy, or that would make a no buy feel kind of incongruous. There's one small thing that's going on, which is that I have decided that I need to find some underwear that I genuinely love that's really comfortable. So I've been slowly buying like one pair at a time from a brand and testing it out for a while and seeing if I like it enough to buy more. I don't think I have yet found the perfect pair. And I think I probably will do a video about this at some point. So if you want to see that, get excited. But the other much bigger and more serious thing that's going on is that we're planning to get married. And, you know, I don't know, I'm not buying a bunch of wedding adjacent stuff, but a little bit. And I just don't want to be doing a thing where it's like, there's like wedding stuff, and then there's stuff for me that's not wedding stuff. And there's anxiety about like, if I decide to, I don't know, buy a pair of earrings to wear, did I buy them for myself? Or did I buy them like for the wedding? Like, does it come from the wedding budget? Or just like, I just don't want to weigh down this like very joyful process with those kinds of shackles, which, you know, have been really, really important to me and useful to me in the past. And I'm not saying that it can't sometimes be the healthiest decision. I think sometimes it is the healthiest decision to shackle oneself in that way. I mean, obviously I think that if I was like going off the deep end and charging like $800 wedding shoes or something, then I would probably be like, slow down, girl. Maybe we need to like put some rules in place. But I'm not. And in fact, I think that a large part of the joy that I'm feeling around planning for a marriage ceremony comes from the fact that I don't feel obsessive. Like, I don't feel an obsessive need to have a bunch of really expensive, glamorous stuff. And I don't feel obsessively perfectionist about planning the wedding, like everything I'll wear and the way that it will go. And that represents real growth for me. And that's really exciting. Regarding shoes, I'm currently feeling like I might just wear an old pair of Tango shoes. I've like vaguely looked for shoes. I haven't seen anything perfect. I haven't spent very much time looking. I haven't obsessively looked, which is really great. If I happen to find a perfect pair, then maybe I'll buy them. Of course, if I do that, they'll be well within our budget. But either way, we'll be fine. Whether I end up finding shoes to buy or wearing my Tango shoes, either way, we'll be fine. And the fact that either way we'll be fine is better. Like, it feels so much better to me than the intense constraints and rules in place making sure that things stay fine. So I've kind of gotten into the next part of the video, the analysis with that wedding stuff there at the end, but I think that I'm ready to transition to that part of the video now officially. Here's what I think happened. I think that on a macro scale, two events, like when I say what happened, it's like I made the plan and then the plan went awry. The best laid plans of Hannah's like went awry. So there was something about the way that this year went that I didn't anticipate at the beginning of January when I made this plan. I think that there are two major events, as I've kind of indicated, that are the culprits for disrupting the plan for the shopping season. The first one was the vaccination. I vastly underestimated what the effect would be on me of the end of quarantine and how I would want to spend my disposable income. And the other one is, you know, getting married. I didn't know when I made this plan that we would probably be having some sort of marriage ceremony this year. I think that there's a third thing, which is that I have watched myself behave in the way that I've been behaving during this time. And I've gotten to see what, I didn't plan it this way, but because it went this way, I've gotten to see what happened, like to see the way that I would act if I didn't have such strict rules. This is the first time since my no-buy year, these past four months, this has been the first time since my no-buy year that I didn't have a really strict budget in place. And it's also the first time since my no-buy year that I wasn't accountable to you guys. Like, I haven't been reporting back on every dollar spent and every single thing that I purchased. And so it's just been me. Like, it's just been me, my desires, my bank account, my muscles of moderation, just accountable to me on my own terms. So in a way, it's been like an unexpected and unplanned true test of what the last 3 years have turned me into. It's like I was going along after my no-buy year with training wheels, you know? And then like someone took the training wheels away and I kept going and I didn't notice for a while. That's like what the beginning of these 4 months was like. And then I like looked down and noticed that they weren't there. And I was like, I'm doing it. I'm doing it. I'm like successfully moderating without strict rules. What I have found is that the desire not to spend too much, my desire not to spend too much, is stronger than my desire for beautiful things. And this might sound obvious, especially to those of you who have never struggled the way that I struggled in the past, or have never like been in that headspace of delusion. But to me, it's a big deal, right? Like, it's so different from how it used to be for me. I know what's in my bank account. I know what my prospects are for income, and I just don't want to upset the balance. That's what's keeping me from buying the Ulla Johnson dresses and the Miu Miu sunglasses. And I also, you know, I'm also aware that I have a strong desire for quality over quantity, and we don't have that much space. And I just don't want to have too many things. And so that has helped me to not buy things, even when they have been relatively affordable or very affordable for me. Sometimes when it's not worries about my bank account that's keeping me from buying something, it's this other thing. It's like the part of me that's like, but do you really want like another package to come in the mail? Do you really want another thing to go into your drawer that's already kind of full? What I've found is that even without strict rules in place, those voices are really loud. The voice in me of financial prudence and the voice in me of quality over quantity, they're loud enough to actually have a serious impact on my decision-making process. And that has been a really, really amazing discovery, which, you know, I mean, maybe you're not surprised, but I am very gratified to know that in this 4 months of riding without the training wheels, that has still continued to be true. One of the things that I'm still definitely doing is using browsing online as a way to de-stress and unwind, especially when I get really, really stressed. Like, for example, the past couple of weeks, there's been like a 10-day period in the past couple of weeks that was like really, really like 110% stress level because of some stuff that's been going on. In the middle of those 10 days, there was like a 2 or 3 day period where I got the idea that I wanted to have some summer sandals that looked like fluffy bedroom slippers. I think that I was inspired by those UGG sandals. I wasn't like, I want those UGGs, but I suddenly got it in my head. I was like, wouldn't it be really chic and like fashion forward and fun to have sandals that are actually like for going outdoors, that are actually summer sandals, but they're like fur, ridiculous, like big puffs of fur and like really like a neon color or something like that. So I got this idea and then I started looking around all over the internet. I basically did like a deep dive of intensive research into this type of thing. And for those couple of days, I kind of spent long hours like with my face glued to my computer screen. I was like looking at, I did look at the UGG ones on Nordstrom's. I looked at all of these dupes on Amazon. I looked at other ones from other brands. I looked on Poshmark to see if there were any of them there. I like sent pictures. I texted pictures of some of them to a friend. And I was like, which one of these do you think is better? I behaved in the way that a person behaves when she's like trying to just, when she's getting it up to buy a thing. You know what I mean? I like spent all of this time and I did it in the way that people like play video games, you know, to unwind. I just, at the end of the day, I was just like, I can't anymore. And I just like plugged in to this fluffy shoes research, basically, you know, for a couple of days. And then I sort of moved on from it. And, you know, in an ideal world, I would do less of that kind of thing or none at all. You know what I mean? If I was like perfect, if I was like in my final form, I would just like read and meditate whenever I needed to unwind. And I wouldn't do any of that like screen consumption, clicking, scrolling stuff. But the dramatic difference between that bad habit and what I used to do before my no buy year is that I almost never buy anything. And I didn't buy any fluffy shoes. And I'm not going to, right? I like got it out of my system without buying any of them. What happened was I like kind of narrowed it down to the ones that I thought would work. And then I was just like, but if you don't buy these, you'll be fine. You'll forget about the idea of fluffy shoes in a couple of weeks. You'll have this money still in your bank account, or you could put it into savings and you can just wear your other sandals. And then it was just over. The bubble kind of popped and I moved on. So as I keep working on myself and keep evolving, I would like to become someone who spends less time overall looking at online shops on her screens. But I think that what I've realized over the past 4 months, over this kind of like riding without the training wheels time, is that browsing online shops and thinking about buying stuff is basically just become one of my handful of mild vices, you know, like along with gluten-free beer, cake, wine, scrolling Instagram, potato chips. As I aspire to be my best self, I aspire to do a little bit less of those things. You know what I mean? And I'm always flexing those muscles of moderation when it comes to any of those behaviors, those like kind of addictive vice-like behaviors. But my current level of cake consumption, for example, is like, it's nowhere near threatening my health, my relationships, or my bank account. You know what I mean? It's nowhere near actually impacting my life. And that's how shopping has become too for me. You know what I mean? It's like a treat that I sometimes eat a little bit too much of. But it's just nowhere near threatening my life. And that is enough for me, especially given where I've come from. So what's going to happen next? I'm not entirely sure what's going to happen next. I think that for the fall, I will probably give myself privately a budget for beautiful things. Like I'll decide how much I feel comfortable spending over the course of the final 4 months of the year. I'll continue tracking my no spend days and my spending on the calendar with my star sticker system. That has been working really well for me. But I think that I might be done with public budgeting projects. I think that this might be it. So I'm going to make a separate video sharing with you the actual stuff that I bought. I'm going to film that separately and it's just going to be that, like me sharing with you the things that I bought and sharing how it's going between me and those things. I want to keep talking about quality over quantity on YouTube and I want to keep promoting shopping secondhand for clothing and, you know, loving what you already own. I want to keep fostering love of what I already own in my life. I'm always going to want stuff that I can't have. I'm always going to be using those muscles of moderation and restraint. It's not like I've suddenly become a person for whom all of this is easy and like there's never any struggle and there are no feelings. But really, I'm okay, you know? And I'm ready to let go of the identity of messed up person or person with a shopping problem and just be person who loves fashion and beauty and collects fewer, nicer things on a budget and tries to mostly shop secondhand. Like that, I'm ready to just be that now. But before I go, I want to just be really clear that this is me 3.5 years after starting my no buy, right? I'm now in my 4th year of YouTube and my 4th year of self-imposed rehabilitation. This is my 4th year of saying no to hundreds of desires for hundreds of things, big and small, basically constantly depriving myself of things that I momentarily think that I want, and saving myself thousands of dollars in the process. If one of the reasons that you follow me is that you have a troubled relationship with shopping yourself, like if you're on a no-buy year or you just finished a no-buy year, you're about to start a no-buy year, or especially if you are someone who knows that you need to make a change but you haven't worked up the courage yet to start, No judgment. That was me for years. So if you're still working up the courage to make a change, then what I'm talking about, the stuff that I'm saying is working for me right now, it might not be a model for you. Like, I would not be able to ride without the training wheels right now if I hadn't had them on for a really long time. I personally didn't stop watching hauls and review content during my no buy year. I wanted to stay abreast of the trends. I wanted to stay in the community. And also, I wanted to become a person. I didn't want to be a person who had removed temptation entirely from her life. You know, I wanted to become a person who could face temptation and still not give in to it. So I just kept going along. I kept seeing beautiful things, becoming aware of beautiful things, being tempted and saying no. And that's part of how I developed those muscles. But I know that for some people, a very important first step is removing temptation, like before they can even start down the path. If you need that, then some of my current videos might not be ideal for you. I mean, I'm always trying to temper my excitement about beautiful things on YouTube with like reminders that new stuff, no matter how beautiful it is, it's not going to change your life. It's not going to fix your life. I'm always trying to kind of burst the bubble of the consumerist frenzy with the way that I talk about things, even things that I love, like even really beautiful things. I try to do that with my general outlook and my general attitude. But I'm doing that as someone who does buy new stuff for herself from time to time and who does occasionally review new stuff, new makeup on YouTube. So depending on where you're coming from, it might be better for you to watch my No Buy Year playlist than to watch my new current videos right now, or to watch someone else, or to leave YouTube altogether and watch something else or do something else. And I guess I can also kind of report back, like if you are in the middle of the no buy process, or if you're just like ending a no buy, or if you're doing anything resembling what I did and you're at some earlier stage than I currently am in the process, then I can also kind of report back to you from like the 3.5 year mark that it may be possible to have eventually kind of like a normal, joyful relationship with shopping. At least for me, I found that I was able to loosen the reins considerably over these past 4 months without going off the deep end. And you know, no matter where you're coming from, my level of consumerism or what feels good and healthy to me might not be a match for your approach. Like, that's just the facts of doing something publicly that thousands of people are going to engage in. You know, we're all different. You might have 20 times as much money as I do, but you might still feel like buying 4 dresses in 4 months, which is what I did, is too many. And you might be really judgy about that. That's fine. I feel like we're all just kind of swimming in this world of really intense marketing and ego and identity, trying to find joy and be comfortable. You know, we're all like living in our bodies and trying to make it work for us and seeking the tools for that. And there's no like universal standard or rule book, you know? My own journey has been particularly complicated because on the one hand, I've had to learn restraint, want less, shop less, spend less, because I was wanting and shopping and spending way, way too much. But on the other hand, I've had to learn to let go of control and not push so hard and not try so hard, and to be less perfectionist and less exacting and less punishing of myself, because my perfectionism was at the root of my shopping problem. As I've gotten further along and my inner work has progressed, I've had to let go of control and become less dependent on rules and regulations for my sense of health and well-being. So, you know, I'm on my own karmic journey. And I say that because I follow Ram Dass on Instagram. I mean, he's no longer living, but there's a legacy account that posts quotes from him. And there's a quote just a couple of days ago that was about karmic journeys. Actually, I'm going to find it and read it to you. Okay, I found it. Here's Ram Dass. Are you ready? From the soul's point of view, you come to appreciate that each one of us is living out his or her or their own karma. We interact together, and those interactions are the grist for each other's mill of awakening. From a personality point of view, you develop judgment, but from the soul's point of view, you develop appreciation. This shift from judging to appreciating yourself and what your karmic predicament is, and who other beings are with their own karma, brings everything into a simple, loving awareness. To be free means to open your heart and your being to the fullness of who you are, because only when you're resting in a place of unity can you truly honor and appreciate others and the incredible diversity of the universe. So I feel like making this like spending rehabilitation journey publicly has been an illustration of that. I feel like many of you and I, we together have interacted, and our interactions have been the grist for each other's mill of awakening, you know, as he says. And I love this part about moving into a space of appreciating yourself and what your own karmic predicament is, because that's what I've been trying to explain in this video. I feel like I'm moving into a space of appreciating what my own karmic predicament is. It's this stuff. And I also appreciate that all of you have your own predicaments. You know, everybody's on his or her or their own path. I don't have a final answer for myself or for you guys, but I do believe that I'm doing what's right for me. I love beautiful things and I take pleasure in them. I make videos about them. They bring me joy, but they're not the source of my contentment as a person. And I hope that my content reflects that and will continue to reflect that. I am working towards becoming a person who is the source of her own contentment. And that is what I want for you too. And that is it. We are done here. I appreciate you so much if you watch this video all the way through. I don't even know how long it's going to end up being, but it's going to be a lot longer than most of my videos are these days. So if you're still here, thank you so, so much for seeing it through with me. I appreciate you to no end. And I really, really want you to take extra good care of yourself so that you can be the most effective version of yourself as you do your work in the world.